been making ceramics for probably the last 35 years. I actually trained in commercial art and advertising as a layout artist and graphic artist in my youth, and then worked with an advertising agency in Kenya, where I was born and I come from. And I came to England to probably assuming that I was going to pursue that field and then work in advertising for the rest of my life, until I came across a pottery class. I think on my foundation we did a bit of pottery, and I started going to evening classes. And the rest is history. I wanted to actually make a specific project that was a component of something else, and en masse, and totally separated from my ceramics. I already had made work that was related to my own research and my own interest in anthropology and the history of East Africa and the history of the Nile, the River Nile and its, you know, Blue Nile and White Nile and its tributary and its meandering up to Egypt. It's an area of art history. It's an area of objects, area of anthropology and archaeology that has always been an interest for me. And water has always been an interest for me. Glass has this kind of elusive water quality to it. And on invitation to work with glass, to have the river as an inspiration, but also to have artifacts, the artifacts that are along that whole Nile Valley are to do with, a lot of them are to do with adornment, a lot of them are to do with rites of passage, and my interest in adornment was heightened when I was at doing a bit of research at the University College London at the Petrie Museum, found these ear studs that were just intriguing. They're made from glass, they're 5,000 years BC. When I came here, I thought, wouldn't it be good to have to make these pieces, lay them perhaps in a grave, and discover them in mass, en masse. And the more I started working with them, my other ideas came through. I referred back to the river. I referred back to the fact that at one stage, and I did quite a bit of rock climbing, and so I would have gone into caves. I love natural formation of things like stalactites. And alongside the seriousness of this particular project, there has been an element of testing, teasing, and there's been an element of drama and playfulness to it, because the nature of glass blowing has a very theatrical aspect to it. I have to call it a piece, because it is actually one piece of work made of 1,000, actually we think 1,001 pieces. It is an individual piece in itself. It's involved several people. It's sort of by nature. I think what's been interesting is working with several glass blowers. And in the States, I worked with Benjamin Cobb at the Museum of Glass with his team. At Pilchuck, I worked with David Waters and his teammate, D.H. McNabb, and here James Maskrey, you know, had his own team of students who are working with him and helping him, which is absolutely wonderful, because they got the experience of working with him. I got the experience of working with him, and I had a young assistant who was doing her MA, who trained in architecture, called Patricia Matamora, who visualized the concept I wanted on, I think it's called Rhino, on 3D, you know, sort of on computer, which I wouldn't have known to do. So it's involved several people. I feel that in creating the object in black and then just having, you know, sort of a few colors, has this kind of three-part essence to it, you know, and the three corners meet and don't get broken, as it were.